Salmon of the Stillaguamish River have an incredible history and amazing story. When we think about our salmon, we realize that they have survived centuries through ice ages, landslides, volcanic eruptions, climate changes, and any number of natural disasters. They start their life in our headwaters as these tiny little eggs resting at the bottom of the river in what we call reds, and hatch into tiny little fish called fry. They travel downstream, growing in size, seeking shelter behind fallen logs, large rocks, and under the cover of leafy canopies, all while trying to avoid being eaten by any number of predators. Then, they transform from being freshwater fish to becoming the saltwater fish we know. They have their biggest growth rate yet in the estuary, where they begin breathing salt water for the first time. Smolting is that process. And they go from small little river fish to the ocean-going salmon. They travel from our watershed, leaving the Puget Sound, some heading along the west coast of Canada all the way to the waters of the North Pacific off the south coast of Alaska. When they return back to our waters 2 to 5 years later, they begin another transformation. They've packed on weight, and now they hit the same river system and spend every bit of energy they have to get back to the gravel beds they were born in, to build a red and start the cycle all over again. They've stopped eating as soon as they hit the freshwater, making the upriver journey even more difficult. Having been one of the lucky few that have made it this far, they pushed through a marathon of obstacles to return to their birthplace. Historically, our salmon numbers were in the hundreds of thousands. Today, we only see less than 10% of that. So what happened? In the late 1800s, the first real impacts came. European settlers came to the Northwest. Then industry came. Our rivers were dredged for shipping. The banks of the rivers were hardened to keep the river from wandering. Tree-lined banks became farmland. Dikes were put in place to channel the river and keep out the tides. The habitat used by our salmon began to be drastically reduced. In the early 1900s also began the first modern commercial harvests. This led to what we call the Fish Wars, where Washington State refused to treat Native Americans as citizens with rights and refused to honor and respect the treaties made between the tribes and this great nation. Commercial fishing boats were parked at the mouth of the river with huge nets over-harvesting everything. Our salmon, sturgeon, everything was consumed as fast as possible. When natives tried to fish, we were beaten, gassed, and arrested. By the 1960s, the tribes had been abused for decades and banded together to organize fish-ins on the Puyallup, Nisqually, and other area rivers. Sometimes the state, seeing natives fishing, sent in the police to break up the camps. One particularly violent raid on the Puyallup in 1970 caught the attention of the federal government, prompting them to file suit on behalf of the tribes in federal court. In 1974, Judge Bolt made the historic decision giving the tribes 50% of the harvestable salmon, a decision that changed the course of managing our salmon. This began the much-needed change to how our salmon are sustainably harvested today. At the same time, salmon hatcheries were created to keep fisheries open, partially making up for some of the lost habitat. But on the Stillaguamish River, our hatchery isn't there just to create fish to catch. It exists specifically to keep our salmon from going extinct. Without our hatcheries, we could lose summer and fall Chinook populations entirely. However, our efforts haven't been making enough of a difference. Even today, we still see fishing seasons closed that used to be open. We see certain salmon runs too low for too long. That is why the Stillaguamish Tribe is focused on the three H's necessary for the return of healthy fisheries: harvest, hatchery, and most importantly, habitat. Creating sustainable and fair harvest practices that are coordinated as salmon migrate from the rivers of Puget Sound through Canada and to Alaska and back. Increasing enforcement to curb poaching and overharvest. Building state-of-the-art hatcheries that give our salmon the help they need to increase the amount of salmon that survive the process from going from egg to sea-going smolts. Hatcheries that also supply an education to our younger generation and give us scientific insight into the life, struggles, diseases, and DNA of our fish. But reformed hatchery and harvest practices won't be enough to bring back our fisheries and give us healthy salmon populations. Habitat restoration is what will ensure that our salmon sustain our people 7 generations into the future. Our salmon need complex habitat, and a lot of it. They need log jams, they need shade, they need gravel beds, wide shores, a river that moves, expansive estuaries, mature riparian areas, and a multitude of complex places to hide, eat, grow, rest, hunt, and breed. This is what we strive for. This is what the salmon need today. This is our responsibility as caretakers. This is our culture and traditions here in our hands, and we need to hold these sacred things tightly.